Obviously loyal piece of outerwear, aren't you?
Yeah, speaking of loyalty.
What the?
I know what you're gonna say.
You should not be here.
I was gonna go home.
I don't wanna hear it.
But it was such a long way down, and I just thought about shooting.
And now I gotta hear it.
I'm kinda stuck to the side of the ship, and this suit is ridiculously intuitive, by the way, so if anything, it's kinda your fault that I'm here.
What did you just say?
I take that back. And now I'm here in space.
Yeah, right where I didn't want you to be.
This isn't Coney Island, this isn't a field trip. This is a one-way ticket.
You hear me? Don't pretend you thought this through. I know you didn't.
You
could not have possibly thought this.
You can't be a friendly neighborhood Spider-Man if there's no neighborhood. Okay, that didn't really make sense, but you know what I'm trying to say.
Come on, we got a situation.
Kid, you're an Avenger now.
We all know and love Spider-Man, and within two decades, there have been three different interpretations of the character. We all have our favorite Spider-Man, our favorite Peter Parker, our favorite love interest, our favorite moment, and our favorite movie. But of all three, which one of these interpretations is the most faithful to the story of Spider-Man? We're going to dive into this, focusing on the first installment of each franchise. That's Spider-Man, The Amazing Spider-Man, and Spider-Man Homecoming. Sam Raimi's Spider-Man was the first big deal since Batman, the superhero who pretty much dominated the 90s, and it's all about a girl, like the Superman movie. You see, the theory was that if they could make the romance work in Superman, then the movie would work. And in a lot of ways, Spider-Man followed the same formula. At the center of the Spider-Man movie is a love story. It's of Peter Parker trying to win over Mary Jane, and in the process, he becomes a better person. But there are also other layers in this movie, like the famous line, "Where great power comes great responsibility," which pretty much sums up his character arc. The movie is also about him coming to understand that quote, and therefore, this is a coming-of-age movie. Now, for the most part, this is an origin story that follows all the classic Peter Parker tropes. We have Aunt May and Uncle Ben reflecting the same age they do in the comics. We have Green Goblin as his villain. In the comics, this is his primary villain. We have him swinging through Manhattan, which is iconic when it comes to this character. We have the radioactive spider that bites him. We have Harry as his best friend. We have him as a photographer trying to make ends meet. We have him being a wrestler for some quick cash. Long story short, this depiction of Spider-Man is pretty faithful to the character and comics, even going so far as to have transitions inspired by comic panels. Then we have Mark Webb's The Amazing Spider-Man, another origin story. This movie is based more on the lore of Ultimate Spider-Man than our classic Spider-Man comics. Yes, this movie also have a love story in it, one between Peter and Gwen, and it's also a coming-of-age story, but not quite in the same way. Yes, Peter gets bitten by a spider and gains superpowers. Yes, his Uncle Ben tells him that with great power comes great responsibility before dying. However, there are also small creative differences that make things different. This movie is darker. Unlike the 2002 Spider-Man, this one doesn't feel like it was ripped out the comics, it feels realer. And ironically, this one follows the more traditional structure of a hero's journey. That journey starting with the ordinary world. This is Peter's everyday life. Next we have the call to adventure, which is when he finds his father's briefcase which leads to him getting bitten by a spider. Next we have refusal of the call. Unsure about what's happening to him, he begins to abuse his powers a bit. He having acting out, upstaging Flash Thompson, and he begins to argue with Uncle Ben. Then we have meeting a mentor. He has four mentors, all who guides him in different ways. Next we have crossing the threshold. The death of Uncle Ben motivates him to find his killer, indirectly leading to him becoming a crime fighter, which is shown when he's in his Spider-Man suit for the first time. Then we have Tessa's allies and enemy, which is when all his relationships develop, with Gwen, with his mentors, with Aunt May, and even a villain. Then we have approach to the inmost cave. Spider-Man fights the lizard and tries to figure out a number of ways to stop him. Then we have the ordeal, which is when Captain Stacy managed to pin him down and force him to reveal his identity, which leads to his reward, which is when Captain Stacy lets him go, showing that he trusts him. Then we have the road back, which is when he makes his way to the villain where the big fight begins. Here we have resurrection. After getting beaten down, he gains some inner strength and saves the day with some help, which leads to the last step in the hero's journey. He returns home with some eggs, showing us he changed. By putting other people first, we see he's no longer Peter Parker, but Spider-Man. Now we have John Watts, Spider-Man Homecoming. Now this one completely sidesteps the origin story the two previous movies explored. It also sidesteps that big romance. Yes, a guy do like a girl, but that's not at the center of the story. However, like the other two films, this one too is a coming of age story. But what makes this one stand out from the others is that this one is part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Now, with all this said, let's get to the point of it all. With three different Spider-Man movies, what are the main differences between them? And how does these differences change the mythos of Spider-Man? So first, let's explore the mythos of Spider-Man. He's known as the everyday guy. For someone so spectacular, he's pretty average. And this is the appeal he has. Just look at his costume. Anyone can put it on and be Spider-Man. And his story serves to reinforce that. He's middle class or dances on that line. He wasn't raised by his parents. He struggles to pay his rent. He takes on odd jobs to make ends meet, despite being clearly overqualified for them. He suffers because he chooses to put other people first. His best friend becomes his worst enemy. He loses his first love. He never reaches full potential in science and financially because others are holding him back. This is a guy who suffers because he's always trying to do the right thing, and that's something we can all identify with. Peter Parker represents all of us. He gets bitten by a random spider, just as any of us could have. No, he's not the result of a super soldier experiment or a god or born in privilege. All that echoes the idea of the chosen one. No, he's not trying to save the world. I mean, he would try if he could. What I'm saying is that he's just trying to do the right thing. And this is what makes him such an intimate character. So now, knowing this, when we look at the films, we must acknowledge what changed and why. The first Spider-Man movie is the most faithful to the Spider-Man mythos as a whole. Some may argue that Andrew or Tom better represent Spider-Man, but it's the Tobey franchise that best depicts Spider-Man for one reason and one reason only, because he's the everyday man. What do I mean? Allow me to explain. In The Amazing Spider-Man, we have the story of the Chosen One, a concept introduced to us in Amazing Spider-Man 2. Which is why he follows the hero's journey so effortlessly. Only Peter Parker could become Spider-Man because of his DNA, meaning if any of us was bitten by that spider, nothing would have happened. This makes Peter Parker special, well, more special than the rest of us. It also makes him privileged, as it's a gift from his father. And all this translates to him being the chosen one. He doesn't become Spider-Man because of his personal choices. It's now his destiny. In addition, this Peter Parker had four father figures in the form of Richard Parker, Ben Parker, Kurt Connors, and Captain George Stacy, meaning his journey from boy to man is represented through them. So on the surface, it seems like he comes from a broken home, but in reality, he have a lot of guidance. Furthermore, all these men are extraordinary in their own right. I mean, they have strong moral codes, extreme intelligence, and great influence. So in a nutshell, The Amazing Spider-Man is exactly what the title suggests, amazing. He might as well be a Skywalker at this point because there is nothing average about this guy. So what about Spider-Man Homecoming? I mean, they clearly sidestepped the origin story to many people's relief. The story made no mention of him being the chosen one. So yeah, he can also lay claim to the everyman hero Peter is known as. Well, not quite. And perhaps this is due to a domino effect. In 2002, this Spider-Man movie had no predecessors, so it was able to dive into the Spider-Man mythos without fear of repetition. However, in 2012, after three Spider-Man movies, there was a strong desire to set this interpretation of Spider-Man from the others, which resulted in a darker movie. Rather than him fighting crime in the day, he now fights crime at night. Where once his father was never mentioned, now his father plays a huge role in his development. where once he was the common man, now he's the chosen one. Spider-Man Homecoming suffers from the same thing. It's trying to set itself apart from the other Spider-Man movies, but also it has the task of placing him in the MCU. So how does this translate? Well, for one, we don't get an origin story. That means no Spider-Bite and no Uncle Ben. We have no Green Goblin, his classic villain, because that already been done. That also means no Harry. No Gwen or Mary Jane, instead we have Liz. No camera or Daily Bugle, instead we have a smartphone. No Swinging Through Manhattan. Both the other Spider-Man movies took full advantage of the iconic imagery. Instead, he stays in Queens, and sometimes is forced to figure out how to travel with no buildings. None of this is bad, by the way, just an observation. But then we have something that completely changes the character of Peter Parker, and that's Tony Stark. Peter Parker being in the MCU completely changes his character. This is something that makes sense, something even explored in Ultimate Spider-Man comics. However, what he embodies suffers as a result. As part of the MCU, his goal is clear. He wants to be an Avenger, and everything he does comes from that motivation. He's no longer just a kid trying to figure out life as he comes to manhood under, for the most part, usual circumstances. He now has a purpose that works against his agency, as his goal is something that is provided from another person. This brings us to the Spider-Man suit. Yes, making it high-tech distinguishes it from the other Spider-Man movies, but it also communicates something to the viewer. Privilege. Something that Spider-Man has never been linked to. So with the Amazing Spider-Man, we have a Peter with four father figures. Here, Peter have the ultimate father figure, Tony Stark, the father of the MCU. But that's not who Spider-Man is. He's a guy who is forced to make decisions in life with little to no guidance as he makes his transition into adulthood, much like Peter in the original franchise. The Spider-Man of myth don't have an Obi-Wan Kenobi character to put him on the right path, to call him to adventure, who gives him a magical item to help him on his journey. The Spider-Man of myth isn't known as the Chosen One, nor do he aspire to be an Avenger. The Spider-Man we all know and love is just a guy dealing with life, one step at a time. He struggles to make ends meet, was raised by his aunt, gets with the girl next door, struggles to balance his life, has a dysfunctional family. He makes his best friend and archenemy the godfather of his daughter in one storyline. Which sounds pretty wild when you say it out loud, but then again, that's pretty normal. That is what makes Spider-Man the everyday guy.
Peter, these are the years when a man changes into the man he's going to become the rest of his life.
Just be
careful who you change into. This guy, Flash Thompson, he probably deserved what happened. But just because you can beat him up, doesn't give you the right to. Remember, with great power comes great responsibility.
That's what's at stake here. Not choice, responsibility.
You'll never guess who he wants to be. Spider-Man.
Why?
He knows a hero when he sees one. Too few characters out there flying around like that, saving old girls like me.
Lord knows kids like Henry need a hero. Courageous, self-sacrificing people, setting examples for all of us. Everybody loves a hero.
People line up for them, cheer them, scream their names. And years later, they'll tell how they stood in the rain for hours just to get a glimpse of the one who taught him to hold on a second longer. I believe there's a hero in all of us that keeps us honest, gives us strength, makes us noble, and finally allows us to die with pride.
Want to hold this?
Even though sometimes we have to be steady and give up the thing we want the most. Even our dreams. Spider-Man did that for Henry, and he wonders where he's gone. He needs him.
Why are you doing this? I gotta know, what's your MO? What gets you out of that twin bed in the morning?
Because I've been me my whole life, and I've had these powers for 6 months. Mm-hmm. I read books, I build computers. And yeah, I would love to play football, but I couldn't then, so I shouldn't now.
Sure, because you're different.
Exactly. But I can't tell anybody that, so I'm not. When you can do the things that I can, but you don't.
Hey, what the?
And then the bad things happen.
Money in the bag.
They happen because of you.
So you want to look out for the little guy, you want to do your part, make the world a better place, all that, right?
Yeah. Just looking out for the little guy.
I know we all think that we're immortal. We're supposed to feel that way. We're graduating. But, like our brief 4 years in high school, what makes life valuable is that it doesn't last forever. What makes it precious is that it ends. And I know that now more than ever. And I say it today, of all days, to remind us that time is luck. So don't waste it living someone else's life. Make yours count for something. Fight for what matters to you, no matter what. Because even if we fall short, what better way is there to live?
I don't know what to do.
You start by doing the hardest thing. You forgive yourself. I believe in you, Peter. You're a good person. And I know you will find a way to put it right. In time.
It's easy to feel hopeful on a beautiful day like today. But there will be dark days ahead of us too. There will be days where you feel all alone. And that's when hope is needed most. No matter how buried it gets, or how lost you feel, you must promise me that you will hold on to hope. Keep it alive. We have to be greater than what we suffer. My wish for you is to become hope. People need that. And even if we fail, what better way is there to live? As we look around here today at all of the people who helped make us who we are, I know it feels like we're saying goodbye, but we will carry a piece of each other into everything that we do next, to remind us of who we are and of who we're meant to be. They've had a great 4 years with you.
Slower, gently.
Is he alive?
He's just a kid. No older than my son.